Hello, in this video we are going to look at how to carve an Easter egg. This is a really simple and fun project. I like it a lot because it's a great way to learn about wood grain and direction, and it's a great project that you can do with your kids as well. So the final product are going to be these little Easter eggs, and our process is going to be to carve the egg, paint the egg, carve the detail on with sorted V tools and gouges, and then finish them. So I'm going to move these things out of the way and we can go ahead and get started. What you're going to start with is a blank for the egg. I'm using 3/4 inch thick basswood, and you can get a link to the pattern in the description or in my link tree. And you just print that out, trace it around, and then you can cut that out. I used a bandsaw to cut this one out. And if you don't have a bandsaw, you can obviously use a bandsaw or a scroll saw. You could use a coping saw. It's so slight that you could even cut it out with a straight saw and just carve the rest of it out if you wanted to. So before I start carving, what I'm going to do is mark a center line down the middle of it, all the way around on the sides. And of course a wood carver's got to use your Wood Spirit carved pencil, right? So I'm just gonna draw a center line here. It doesn't have to be perfect. I can eyeball that, and I kind of use my rest it against my finger and get that pencil where I want, so I can run it back and forth and keep that about the same distance all the way across, so that I can get a center line marked down the sides all the way around on my egg. All right, the knife that I'm going to use today is a 2-inch flex cut roughing knife. This is one of my favorite flex cut knives, just because it's really big and really sharp, and is helpful for doing this kind of large work. Any knife will work, but a large heavy duty knife is nice for this. It makes things a little bit quicker. And one of the things that we're going to note is that as we carve, if you've been carving for very long, you figured this out, but if not, you always want to carve with the grain in the direction that I always say is uphill. So I'm going to find that widest point of the egg, and if it's helpful, you can draw it on like that. And what that means is, if you think about the grain going up like this, I always want to carve uphill. If I'm carving uphill, I'm slicing off the ends, and that goes really smoothly. If I'm carving downhill, my knife's constantly getting caught in the grain and getting pulled back in, and that's going to result in much more ragged cuts, and it's not going to go as well for you. So we're just going to remember to carve uphill. If I'm holding it like this, that's going to be that way. If I'm holding it like this, that's going to be that way. And to carve the shape of the egg is pretty easy. What I like to do is I take 4 different passes to get it. So the first pass, what I'm going to do is really try to go in at about a 45 degree angle and just go pretty deep all the way along. And you can see I've got a nice sharp knife, makes those cuts pretty easy. And I'm going at about a 45 degree angle and leaving, you know, a little bit of space left. I'm not getting all the way down to the line. So in my first pass, I'm only getting up to about there. I'm going to do the same thing back down in the other direction, like that. And this middle spot, you can decide which way you want to go. All right, and I'm going to switch over to the other side and do the same thing. About a 45 degree angle, get some big cuts there. Take that hard corner off at the top. Might be a little bit tricky to get. Sometimes you can come up in the middle and just go like that to get it. Flip it around. I'll do the same thing back in the other direction. Now, so it's pretty good. So it was a little bit uneven there, so I came back and did that. So then I'll do the other side, same exact thing, 45 degree angle, taking off that hard corner as much as I can, do that on both sides, as I get towards the top. It might be easier to just come in and lop off the top. You can check here and make sure you've got a roughly even line going around. I'll flip it around and go the other direction. There we go. That is pass one all the way around. Going pretty quick. You might want to take your time a little bit and make sure that you're getting it even. But the nice thing is it doesn't have to be perfect. It can be a little bit uneven and slightly different, and the facets will end up looking really nice. So that's our first pass. Our second pass to carve is that I'm going to come here and I'm going to take the hard corner off that's left, and I'm going to take it up to right up to, but not over the center line. So that's going to look about like this, so that I'm carving kind of right along the center line, taking that off, and turn it around and do the same thing going down. So you can see again, I'm carved right up to that center line, but not quite there. Okay, flip it over. Do the same thing on this side. Right up to it. If your knife is nice and sharp, you'll be able to do it right across this top here too. And same thing coming down. Just taking that corner off, right up to the middle line. Now, it might be hard to see, but if I get this kind of tearing look in the wood going this way, I'm going to flip it around. I'm going to go back the other way, and it should come off a little bit smoother. That center spot where it's kind of at the outer edge of the curve, you might be able to carve it up or down. If it starts to rip one way, turn around and go the other way. Okay, and do the exact same thing on this side now. Again, just taking off that hard edge so that all that is really going to be left is the center line. Do that on each of the sides, going up and going down. Okay. So now what I've got on the sides is basically that hard center line going up and around each side. So for my third pass, and what I'm going to do is just carve that center line off. So I'm going to go straight up the outside here and carve straight down the middle to carve that high ridge off right up to the top. Same thing on the other side. Carve right up to the top of that ridge. There you go. And then flip it around and go downwards towards the bottom. Same thing. Just carve that center ridge off, and there in kind of three passes, we got a nice shape with great facets on the outside to get that egg shape. So then my fourth pass is just going to be to soften the edge here. So I'm going to come in here at a much more shallow angle and just shave that hard line off, pull it back a little bit. Again, uphill on both sides, straight up in the middle. Flip it over. Same thing on these sides. Now, when I do that here, I like to also, first of all, cut it in a little bit tighter on the bottom. And actually, you can do that all the way around the sides. Just tuck it in a little bit. It really accentuates that egg shape. And then do one line just across the bottom. Okay. Same thing here. All right, we'll do the same thing on this side, bringing in that fourth pass at the bottom. Just tuck it in a little bit more there. One shave across the bottom like that. And then bring that hard edge in. So that will be the end of my fourth pass all the way around the egg, and then the egg is basically carved. Now, if you want to, if you don't like this really flat edge and you really want the faceted look across all of it, You got a couple options. If you've got a long knife, you can keep doing this and you can actually shave it down. So you don't have any of the, sawed machine surface on there. You could also do something like, grab a number three gouge and go across it like this to just add some nice carved facets to it. You can see I did that in this example. And I like that. I'm not going to take the time to do it in this video. I don't think it's bad to leave that as it is either. Just a matter of preference. So that is it for carving the egg. Pretty easy, but the nice thing about it is you can use that same method, that four-pass method. You cut whatever shape you want out of 3/4-inch basswood and carve just about anything you want by just rounding the edges, and it's a really handy, easy thing to do. So the next step is going to be to paint the egg. I'm not actually going to record myself painting, but I have a painted egg here as an example. So what I would normally do is the color I'm using in this case is called Fresh Cut Grass from Folk Art. Pick whatever color you want, obviously, and I've got examples in some other colors as well. This was Fresh Cut Grass. A tip on that is that I use these. It's just a scrap wood with a screw in it, and then I drill a little pilot hole on the bottom of the egg so that I can screw that in. It's enough that I can do it by hand. That gives me something to hold while I paint. I really don't water the paint down much for this. It's pretty much just pure paint, but you can water it down, use whatever colors you want. So paint it, let it dry really good, several hours overnight if you can. And the next step is going to be to carve the patterns onto it. So for that, you can see some examples again that I've got here. This is the fun part. You can decorate your eggs. It's essentially decorating eggs. When everybody else has got their dyed eggs that they're drawing and coloring on with crayons, you can get out your wood eggs and you can paint them and decorate them. And you can use, this is a great place to use your V tools and your micro gouges and everything else that you've got laying around to try out. So, and then it gives you that great look of you see the wood through the spot where you've carved. So I'm going to use this one as a model. We're going to go for the flower pattern. I think these are pretty straightforward. If you have a super sharp V tool, you can do the spirals and use your V tool to just make some kind of fun patterns on it. Have fun, make up your own designs. To do this flower pattern, they kind of remind me of tulips. I'm not a flower expert, but I think they kind of look like tulips. I'm going to use two tools for that. I'm going to use my, this is a 5 mm U gouge from Dockyard. And this is a 1/4-inch V tool from Drake. You can use whatever brand you want, whatever you got laying around is fine. The key is that they're sharp, so make sure you strop them before you use them. So I'm going to, this is the one I just carved. I'm going to set it aside. I'm going to use this one I already had painted for this next part. So, just gonna clean my workspace here out a little bit. Okay, so I'm gonna show you how I do this, but again, you can do whatever pattern you want. I am going to carve that tulip pattern, and the way I'm gonna do this, I'll show you here first, is using my micro U gouge. I'm gonna start from the top to the bottom. I'm gonna do the middle one first. And then I'm going to go to the sides and do those two. So I'm making three cuts with my U gouge to get that. So I'm gonna put one up kind of towards the top here, maybe facing to the side a little bit. I'm gonna go in deep with my U gouge, pop it out. Perfect. Then we go right next to it, kind of parallel, go in the same way, but then I'm gonna curve down to the bottom like that. Okay, same thing on the other side. I'm going to start parallel to my original one, but then as I cut, I'm going to curve in towards the bottom like that. You might have a little bit of a chip there in the middle. You can come back the other direction, carve that out. Perfect. So there's a fun little tulip shape. All right, then I'm going to use my V tool and I'm going to create the stem for the flower. So I'm going to start at the base of the flower. I'm going to start kind of shallow, and I like using the quarter inch V tool. Use whatever you want, but it lets me start shallow and then get deeper as I go down. So I'm going to start kind of shallow and keep it thin. And then as I get towards the bottom, I'm going to curve it around, make it a little larger, and there we go. You can always run back over it there. It tore a little bit. If I'm getting that, I might go in the other direction too and do that. And yeah, so we got my stem. So next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add two more flowers, probably one on each side. So let's do one here. Same thing from the center down, parallel to that, and kind of curve into the side. Parallel to that, kind of curve into the side. If you're worried about this, you can test it on any piece of scrap wood. Just grab a piece of wood and practice on it. You can even paint it if you want to, and try your hand at different patterns or designs. Come up with your own. You could test it out before you do it on an egg that you've invested time into carving and painting. But so I'm going to do that one, and I'll do another one on this side here. Same thing, top to bottom, to the side. Bring it up to the bottom of the flower, like that. Okay, now we've got three nice tulip blooms. Okay, I'm gonna add some smaller stems that kind of run along the side of this one. And do that however you want. Okay, so there we've got my three blooms coming out, and then I'm just gonna add some more, I don't know, grass, foliage, petals around the bottom, maybe a couple like that. And I'll just do a couple on both sides, kind of coming in and down. Okay, if you're not confident about it, you could draw it on with your pencil first and then do it. You can also always start by going really shallow first. Sometimes I'll do that if I'm not sure what I'm doing, really shallow like that, and then I can do a second pass coming in just like that and get it a little bit deeper. So, pretty simple but fun, straightforward. And you can experiment with any shapes or things that you want. So that's pretty good. You get these really fun, colorful shavings, which is always a blast. Adds a little color to your pile of shavings. All right, so we are done carving that. And the last step is going to be to finish it. So I'm going to go ahead and do that right now. You could leave it like that. There's nothing wrong with that. I kept mine like that last year mostly. I don't put boiled linseed oil on these. The reason for that is the linseed oil really tends to darken up the top, and that doesn't bother me on some things, but on the eggs, when I tried this last year, the tops turned so dark, and the inside tops on any of the patterns that I carved turned so dark that I really didn't like the way that it looked. So I left a lot of these unfinished just with the paint directly on, like this last year, which is totally fine. You can do that. But this year I've started to experiment with the Howard's Feed and Wax. So we'll go ahead and finish this with Howard's Feed and Wax. This is how I do it. If you do it a different way, let me know. I squirt some out on my paper plate there. Usually, I won't do this until I've got a few things to do, so I probably got more than I need there, but that's okay. And then I'm going to use a cheap disposable sponge brush. I like those because I can use them a few times and throw them away. The other thing I'm going to do, like I showed you before, so that I can hold it a little bit easier, is I'm going to put my holder back onto it. Okay. And then I'm just gonna get my feed and wax mixed up here, get some onto the end of my brush and cover my whole carving in it. I want to make sure I really get into those lines and holes carved by the gouge. Okay, but then also I want to cover the paint. Now the other fun thing about this is you could do two-sided. I didn't do it this time, but you could carve a different pattern on the back. So you could do something like flowers on one side and you know, a nice line pattern on the other side, and then depending on your mood you can flip it around, or maybe you want to write something on one side. Anyway, you can do that however you want, and that's the fun of this project. All right, so everything's covered. Instructions on Howard Feed and Wax says to let it sit for 20 minutes. So sometimes I'll let it sit for a while, but for the sake of time here, I'm going to go ahead and wipe it off. I personally like using this is a cut up piece of t-shirt, and I don't know, it just seems softer and a little bit more absorbent than the paper towels that I generally have around. So a lot of people use paper towels, that's probably fine. And then I'm just going to rub the excess off. Okay. And that's it. It's pretty straightforward. I love the Howard Feed and Wax as a finish on this. It gives the wood just enough of a tint to feel like it's finished, but not so much like the linseed oil does on this to make it feel like overkill. And then it gives a really nice sheen to the paint when you're done too. So you can still tell that looks wet. I toweled it off. So what I'm going to do is let it sit for a while. And then in several hours, or maybe tomorrow morning, I'm going to come back. And this is a shoe brush. Bought it in the shoe section of my general purpose store. And you just bring this back and brush it off, and it buffs up pretty nicely. You might do that a few times if you want to. But that's it. So you can see the examples that we've got here. In about 20 minutes, we're able to carve and do everything. The only difference is that if you did this live, you'd want to let your paint dry before you did the carving. It's a great little project. You can carve a ton of these and give them out on Easter and be a superhero. You can let your kids paint them. You can let your kids carve them with proper safety equipment, of course. For my daughter, because holding the egg and the knife is a little bit challenging, she carves them with a number 3 gouge like this, and we'll usually have a rig on the table where she can hold that and carve that way. So that's another option if you don't want to use your knife or you don't have your knife. You can make bigger eggs, smaller eggs, whatever you want. Infinitely customizable. So thanks for watching. I look forward to seeing all the eggs you all make. Thanks. Bye.